living our lives off of spiritual defibrillators. We are patching up what we feel God wants. But what God wants, somebody say, a new heart. Somebody say, a new heart. And God loves you so much, guys. He said here, I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh. And I will give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit within you. Thank you, Jesus. And cause you to walk in my statutes, meaning my commands. What I have asked of you. In your own physical ability, you don't have certain ability to get rid of certain habits and addiction. God said, I am going to give you this new heart. Somebody say, Lord, do surgery on me.
Lord, do surgery on me.
And ye shall keep my judgments and do them. Let's define the word heart. The heart is one of the most important organs in the entire human body. It is really nothing more than a pump composed of muscle which pumps blood throughout the body. Beating, I've researched and found, 72 times per minute. Wow. Isn't that awesome? The heart pumps the blood. My mother's a nurse. I'm sure she knows. She's kept a lot of people alive. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. The heart pumps the blood, which carries all the vital materials which help our bodies function and removes the waste products that we do not need. For example, the brain requires oxygen and glucose. Make sure I'm right. Which, if not received continuously, will cause you to lose consciousness. Amen. Muscles need oxygen, glucose, and amino acids, as well as the proper ratio of sodium. I'm explaining this because the Lord's going to take us somewhere. Calcium and potassium salts in order to contract. Normally, the glands need sufficient supplies of raw materials from which to manufacture the specific secretions. If the heart ever ceases to pump, Minister Parker, blood, the body begins to shut down, and after a very short period of time, you will relationship, bringing it home, our relationship with God, it is simply a matter of the heart. God is not concerned about performance or formality. God is concerned about the condition, somebody say, of your heart. For so long in the church, we have patched up our existing heart. I want you to hear the Holy Ghost. We have given ourselves a sense of accomplishment. But in reality, over 75% of the Church of the Living God have not truly yet been converted. I'm walking heavy. I need you to pray for me now. Being converted, listen, for us Christians, it means a change of character. Holy Ghost, I thank you. It is to cause you to turn from an evil life to a righteous life. The Holy Spirit said, son, do you understand what conversion means? He said, Amandomos. He said, conversion simply means I told you in my word that you to be conformed to the image of my dear son. So our own formality and customs, it overrides to the original design of the Holy Ghost. God created us and he formed us in the image, not of your baby mama, not of your baby daddy, not of welfare, but he ordained and formed you, somebody say, in his image. Somebody say, in his likeness. So the dilemma becomes, if I have been created in his image, if I have been formed in his likeness, why do I keep struggling?
world? Why do I keep, when I would do good, evil is always present?
Seems the moment I say that I'm going to live for God, that chick waiting right outside to get me in the bed. Why am I still struggling to be converted? Yo Shammai.
And the only way that as a people of God that we can embrace conversion and maintain our identity in Christ, we must receive the power of the Holy Ghost. The Holy Spirit, He is the keeper of our soul. If this building was not here, my relationship with God is not predicated on Sunday at 3 o'clock. My relationship with God is 365 days a year.
And everything that I am facing, He is yet giving wisdom how to navigate. If you're having problems with where you are in life, it's because you have not embraced the Holy Ghost. You've embraced tradition. You've embraced religion. You've embraced your pastor, but you have not embraced the Holy Ghost.
And it's my dear Kabahopa. It is very difficult to receive when you won't let go. It's very difficult for you to embrace a relationship with God when you're halting between two opinions.
Come on, Pastor.
Hold it out.
God has made a distinction. Not God has made. I pray holy fear hits this place. God has made a distinction between us and the world. Bible says in Corinthians to touch not the unclean thing. We cannot operate in the supernatural. We cannot operate in miracles, signs, and wonders. And that's why most of the time our worship service is so difficult to get through, because people have no outside relationship. Holy Ghost. Somebody say hallelujah. In order for us, Holy Lord, help me to stay focused here. In order for us, I want to give you what He said. In order for us as the people of God, Sister Shawan, to receive the new heart, we have to admit, I need a new one.
That's right.
I'm tired of my old ways. Sin and about to bust hell wide open. I need a new one.
Yes.
Somebody say, I need a new one. The new heart, we have to admit that we need a new one. Operating on spiritual fumes will only last for a short period of time.
Come on, Pastor.
If it takes you to get to the zone center or whatever you're a member of, if it takes you having to get to your pastor to hear a word, you're on fumes.
Wow. Speak truth.
God, the Holy Ghost, God is seeking to raise up a church, meaning a people that are prepared for His soon return. Because we have lost our hunger, we give more praise and glory to Jay-Z and Beyonce. We have lost our hunger. We don't see the need to thirst after righteousness. When I grew up in the old day at St. Mark Deliverance Center, my chief apostle taught us to have a relationship with God. And this new 2017 church, I don't know what's going on.
Come on, Pastor.
You make an altar call and we're sitting there like it's not even us.
Come on.
But when the clarion call was made, you began to weep in your seat, and apostle didn't even call the altar yet.
Right.
But hear your Holy Ghost, because there is no thirst after righteousness. We're dying in the pews. Yeah. Yeah. The book of Jeremiah, it reflects the ever worsening situation. Let's talk about the prophet, for this is a prophetic word to us. The book of Jeremiah, it reflects the ever worsening situation Jeremiah encountered. At various times, he had the unenviable task of challenging, that's what I'm doing, challenging religious hypocrisy.
Jesus.
Economic dishonesty. We give what we want to give. We tithe if we feel like tithing. Wow. Economic dishonesty.
Wow.
We spend more time debating with the preacher if the tent belongs to God. It's an issue of the heart.
Amen.
I said it's an issue of the heart. And oppressive practices of Judah's leaders and those who followed them. Jeremiah, listen, was the voice of warning. Your pastor, Pastor Parker, your pastor, man of God, is your voice of warning. To keep the wolves from devouring you. That's why everybody under the sound of my voice, you need a man or woman of God. Because the day that we're living in, these demons and these devils are not playing games. And when the enemy sees you open and available, he will take you. He'll take you with a spiritual date rape drug. Because you're open to the hands of the enemy. Lift your hands and worship him now.
Hallelujah, Jesus.
Lift your hand and worship him.
Hallelujah.
In the next 10 minutes, there's a new heart that's going to drop in this building. Another reason why we have not received the new heart, and I'm cutting through all these notes, I'm going to give you what God said. We're about to flow in the Holy Ghost. Matthew 23:27 says, "Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, church folk in the club, getting high, sleeping around, fornicating all over the place, hypocrites. For ye are like whited sepulchres." I don't preach for money. I preach to save your soul from hell.
That's it.
Oh. "Which indeed appear beautiful outward." Are you looking at Matthew 23:27? "But all within, full of dead men's bones." People are preaching and leading, and their heart is full of dead men's bones. Their heart is full of jealousy. Their heart is full of iniquity. Their heart is full of homosexuality. Their heart is filled with iniquity. Because God is the only person that will allow you to continue to work for him and you've been fired. He said, because gifts and callings come without repentance. That's why no matter how much I preach, Lord, let my heart be for you.
Yes, God.
Doesn't matter what people see. What do you see behind closed doors? How's my attitude with my wife? How's my attitude with my family? Because we as a people cannot bring a person to a level that we've not yet conquered. Somebody say glory. Psalm 66:18. We're almost done. Psalm 66:18. Psalm 66:18 says, "If I regard iniquity," somebody say iniquity. Somebody say
Straight up. That thing that you do, that thing that we all do, because the Bible says all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. If I regard iniquity, I gotta stay here for a moment. If I keep iniquity in my heart, I might not be cheating on my spouse, I might be doing things the right way, I'm not in the world anymore, but if within my spirit I'm still desiring it, I am recording iniquity in my heart. What did the Lord say if we do that? He said the Lord will not hear us. That's how serious God is about sin. Because of you, it separates us from hearing the voice of the Lord. I know we're spending time on career builders and monsters.com looking for jobs and all that. That's great. But sin in your life keeps the voice of God from you. That's why the devil don't want you to worship. Do y'all understand this? That's why the enemy does not want you to enter in, because he knows when you enter in, he no longer has said so. Matthew 15:8. This people draw nigh unto me with their mouth. I'm not impressed when anybody shows up to church. I am impressed when you embrace God. As people draw nigh unto me with their mouth and honoreth me with their lips. Folk do a whole lot of talking, but where you at? Where you at, bro? Where you at? We do a whole lot of talking, but the Bible says they honor me with their lips. Somebody say lip service. Say lip service. But their heart is far from me. How in the world do you think people get divorced? Let's be straight real. How do people stay in a marriage for 25 years and now are divorced? Once your heart is no longer in anything that you're doing, you just exist. You're just on spiritual themes. Lift your hand one more time and say, God, give me a new heart. If you really mean it, lift your hand and say, God, give me a new heart. Our last scripture here. David makes a cry, man of God. One thing about receiving the new heart, as we stated earlier, you have to admit that you need a new one. That's right. If you feel like you're good, man, I'm straight, then this message is not for you. This message is for the hungry. This message is for those that are tired of church and want to experience a move of God. David said, Psalms 51:10, create in me a clean heart, O God. God, create within Carl Wilkins Jr. a clean heart, O God. Put your name in there. And renew a right spirit within me. So that means I might think I'm doing the correct thing. I might believe according to knowledge and precept, because we live in an informational age, that I'm making the right decision. But God, I need you to create a clean heart within me. Somebody say amen. Amen. Somebody say a matter of the heart. A matter of the heart. Last thing here. So the question, I want to leave you with this. Now here to bore you, I want you to stay woke. Somebody say amen. Amen. Most preachers put us to sleep. Let's be real. So the question is, if God has a plan for my life, what have I planned before finding out his will? Wow. I'm just reading what he gave me in prayer. Might be exegete or homiletically
dissect the scripture, I'm giving you what the Lord said. He said, so the question is, if God has a plan for my life, what have I planned before finding out his will? That's career. That's spouse. That's who you're dating. God is concerned about every aspect of our life. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
The prophet Jeremiah knew his purpose. Even though he had to spend 4 decades prophesying, man of God, to a people whose hearts were hardened, because I already know it's always an 80-20 rule. There's still going to be individuals that are still going to leave here, and in your mind, you know what you're doing. But God, whenever he sends a word, he only holds us as ministers responsible for speaking his word, not the outcome. Sometimes ministers, we take too much giving into how they're going to receive me, what if they reject me. It's not personal. But you are responsible, believers. If you are a Christian, whether you are a minister by title, somebody say,
I am responsible for
giving the word. That means if someone comes to you and needs hope and needs deliverance, you don't have to wait to contact your pastor. Find a scripture that can help them. If it's lust, if it's jealousy, if it's drunkenness, find something that you can do to help the person. This ministry, we're about empowering God's people to get you to the next level. What has God called you to do? Amen. I believe that the Lord holds us responsible. I said this for giving his word. Jeremiah did not win a popularity contest. This is probably not going to be aired on CNN and on BET tonight. It's not. Because I'm not here to win a popularity contest. I'm here to confront hypocrisy. I'm here as the pastor to make sure that you are achieving your spiritual destiny. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Somebody say, I have to have a new heart. I have to have a new heart. And you might say, Pastor, this word has challenged me. I know that the Lord through you was talking to me from the very beginning since you said hello. I'm not going to sit here and act like this does not pertain to me. I'm not going to pretend like I have not been existing off of a spiritual defibrillator. But Jesus, I need you to give me that new heart. I want everybody to stand on your feet. Everybody to stand on your feet. And just lift your hands in the glory of the Lord.
Jesus.